happening in this particular scene. This is the first time you see me and Wotan. I am Wotan's wife. We have just had a beautiful castle constructed by some giants. And as payment, my lovely husband has promised my sister, who holds the key to youth and immortality. Obviously, I don't like this. And we're sleeping in the beginning of the scene. We won't be sleeping right now, but we will be sleeping in the show. We're sleeping in this scene, and I wake him up, and I say, we have to wake up, and we start to see this castle in front of us. And I say, do you remember what we have to give these giants as a ransom? And he says, oh, it's okay. I'll figure it out. We'll work it out. It's all right. Don't worry, little one. And I'm furious, and I get more furious. As you'll see. And we go to the point where we see my sister enter and with the giants. So that is this is the opening scene of the second scene of Das Rheingold.
Thank you. Question of the night is one for which I have no answer. why would we want to listen to a middle-aged PhD drone on when we could be listening to this kind of music? I don't know. I have no idea. Oh, this is...
Oh, you... Just for the recording.
Two of them.
Thank you. I hate it when I have to repeat a joke. So, you got it. Okay, all right. I won't repeat it then. Sorry about that. I obviously didn't listen to my instructions, which, as somebody in the room would tell you, is not all that rare. Okay. Well, good evening. So while most of us would prefer to be listening to that again and again, let's just make the best of it tonight. Here we are. I will open with a quote, for it sets up the stage quite nicely. It articulates succinctly my main motivation for tonight's talk. It comes from Lawrence Dreyfus, who's written a nice little book among, as many of you know, Wagner has quite a few books written about him, but this is a nice little book called Wagner and the Erotic Impulse. All books, and I would insert all talks, about Wagner are acts of love or hate, often a strange mixture of the two. While Wagner is an easy man to hate, he has become an increasingly difficult man to love, and his reputation as an unrepentant anti-Semite has prejudiced several generations of listeners against enjoying his music. Amen and amen, as we are wont to say. There's the rub. I said in a Beacon article that actually came out today, we have, I think, with Richard Wagner, an analogous situation that we have with Michael Jackson. Never put those two together, do you often? But whatever ugly issues Jackson possessed, he didn't have the misfortune of having Adolf Hitler as a fan. The architect of the mass genocide never visited Jackson Neverland Ranch, as Hitler did Bayreuth. So why bother with this at all? Why worry ourselves with this horrible, horrible little man, this womanizing, cheating, anti-Semitic egomaniac? Well, the answer to that, as at least many of us in the room believe, is in the ear. We've heard it tonight. Do you remember where you were? Your first Wagnerian moment? Some of you do not, because maybe you were asleep. But others of you, and you may not appreciate this too much, sorry if I offend you, but for others of you, it's not all that different from your first time with sex. You don't forget it. Some of you, like me, maybe what my old Princeton mentor, I went to the Mets version of The Ring in May with a professor of mine, an older professor from Princeton, and his wife, who we subsequently met, who did not go, says that her husband has the Wagner gene, and she doesn't have it. I've already talked to two people tonight in the short span before the meeting who talked about bringing their spouses here at gunpoint. So I know there are a few of you in the room who don't share this Wagner gene. But if you have that gene, then when you heard Wagner, and I mean really heard Wagner for the first time, you had what C.S. Lewis called that nameless conflict of sensations. C.S. Lewis, the Oxford theologian, writer of the Chronicles of Narnia, and other more troubled, very serious tomes, first became acquainted with Richard Wagner as a child. In Surprise by Joy, Lewis tells about being a boy in an English classroom where he first saw Arthur Rackham's illustration of the Ring Cycle. He saw them first visually. Therein, Lewis describes a visual experience that some of us would think, I think, that approaches what we've experienced audibly with Wagner's music. These are his words. The sky had turned round. Pure northernness engulfed me, a vision of huge, clear spaces, hanging above the Atlantic on the edges of twilight, and there arose at once, obviously Lewis is an exceptional young man of sensibility, there rose at once, almost like a heartbreak, the memory of joy itself. And I stared around that dusty schoolroom like a man recovering from unconsciousness. And as a friend of mine likes to say, he walked out of that room bumping into the furniture as he went. Well, Lewis then wrote a poem based on the synopsis of The Ring that he then later read, and he describes hearing for the first time, and you know his generation by his word here, in a gramophone shop, he heard an excerpt of the Ride of the Valkyries. From that moment on, Wagnerian records, Lewis says, became the chief drain on my pocket money and the presents I invariably asked for. Music was one thing. Wagnerian music, quite another. And there was no common measure between them. It was a new kind of pleasure, and I love this, if indeed pleasure is the right word, rather than trouble, ecstasy, astonishment, and again, this conflict of sensations without a name. So where are you? Some of you may be asleep already. But if you're here with that Wagner gene, then maybe you know what I'm talking about. My story, I won't belabor, but my story is one of appreciating opera as a young man, college student, loving, and even before loving classical music, being introduced to opera in college. And I appreciated opera in sort of a I guess I would call it a mid-level, mediocre sort of way. I like the kind of stuff, Scott, that you've done the last 19 years. But it wasn't until living in Paris and we had a man who came through and he was singing Billy the Butt at the Bastille, and his next gig was singing King Mark and Tristan for the Welsh National Opera. And he invited me over. And Cecilia had another gig herself. And so I drove myself across the channel to Wales. And it was there that from that moment when Tristan opened with that extraordinary prelude that I'll talk more about next week. In fact, I'll play a bit of it next week. From that moment where you heard that Tristan chord, those next 5 hours disappeared as if they were 5 minutes. Time had no meaning for me, beauty had no boundary, and the variety of my emotions created a whole new alloy of feelings. The Tristan chord. Extraordinary. And the rest of the opera, amazing. Well, okay. So enough of that. I hope that at least some of us in the room agree that the music is sublime. But it's also true that the man is sinister. Ought we feel hypocritical? Ought the music, however lovely, be banned out of respect for 20th century realities? For a horror that we dare not really, even today, think about too vividly. Tonight, I want to do these three things relatively briefly. I hope they feel briefly. And I hope it feels brief, at least. And then after some time, I hope we have a moment for some comments and your thoughts and reactions and questions, if you have them. There are probably people in the room, even better versed, certainly better versed than I should say, to answer some questions. I want to talk about his anti-Semitism, not to explain or to excuse the inexplicable or the inexcusable. Wagner was an idiot in his view of Jewish people, full stop. His views were evil, pernicious, but I want to say this. The guilt by association that results from Hitler's love of his music is unfortunate, maybe you'd say unjustified. You know, Hitler also loved vegetables, but most of us go on eating them. So is that a fair analogy? Number two, I want to talk briefly about Nietzsche. For the assumption so often is that this all-moral philosophy who argued for a kind of proto-Nazi Superman who maybe we could trace some intellectual roots of Nazism in his philosophy, that he had influence on Wagner. Not true. And I'll talk about that briefly. Thirdly, and again, even more briefly, I want to introduce a few of the themes that I will delve into more next week. What did Wagner want to do artistically? For any statement about Richard Wagner, if any statement can be said to be unquestionably true, it is certainly this one. Wagner did not want his music simply to entertain you. He was after your soul. And he thought that his music could change, if not your soul, he certainly believed at various points, the world for better. Richard Dreyfuss, who I quoted earlier at the beginning, tells a story about being an undergrad at Yeshiva University. And he said, as an undergrad, he wrote a briefly researched paper on Wagner's relationship to the Holocaust. And he tried to trace a kind of direct link. And then he says, after writing the paper, hadn't turned it in, but he wrote it, and he sat down and he listened to the prelude of Tristan and Isolde. And this is what he says. The shock of that musical experience forced me to admit that my denunciation was hypocritical. Love and hate, those are the words of the night. We know that the worship of Wagner, Wagnerality, does get a bit much, sometimes doesn't. Maybe you think it's already gotten there tonight. I don't know. But Ludwig II, of course, who financed towards the end of Wagner's career, financed a great deal of his music and his life, the King of Bavaria, said this to Wagner. I can only adore you, only praise the power that led you to me. I feel I cannot reward you as you deserve. Now that's just one example of countless of letters that this King of Bavaria wrote to Wagner in absolute adoration, probably in complete and total love. He undoubtedly was in love with Wagner. Well, okay, maybe that can be dismissed as a kind of homosexual love letter, but Wagner had this same effect even on those who had every real reason to hate him. For example, just again, one example, Hans von Bülow, whose wife was to bear 3 out-of-wedlock kids to Wagner and then marry him. You would think he wouldn't be in love with this man. This is what he said. This glorious, unique man whom one must venerate like a god. Wow. And some did. But of course, such veneration for such music is charming, and we might, so what if there was the occasional sexual indiscretion, the running from everyone who loaned him money. I mean, who of us in the room is going to cast the first stone, right? But then there's this. In an essay written in 1850, and I won't give you the German title because Cecilia always criticizes my German pronunciation, but the English translation is Jewishness in Music. Wagner criticized Jewish musical rivals and claimed that the Jews, an alien race, were destructive to German society and culture, and that most Germans were repelled by them. He never repented publicly in print to these views. And I want to make it clear tonight, it is not my business to forgive him. He's guilty of being vile, period. But I want to share 5 things that I've learned in my evident love of Wagner and his music that nuance at least my understanding of what is forever reprehensible and forever unforgivable. And afterward, maybe you can tell me, do these things make a difference? Do they matter? For example, 1, he hated the French too. He had, early in his career, a horrible experience in Paris. For 2.5 years, he had utter dejection. He felt rejected by the opera establishment, which was, in fact, led by 2 Jewish men, one Maybearer and Halevi, who was both the kind of the first and the second of those who led the Jewish, the opera establishment in Paris. Now, there are varying views on this, of course, as there always are in these historical events. He likely expected a better reception than he had reason to expect. I mean, he was a bit of a megalomaniac. But the bottom line is, he really was not at all received well, and that experience colored forever his view of opera and of those who kind of held the purse strings or held the power. They didn't welcome him with open arms in Paris. And he wrote, not just in the work I mentioned, but often about the undue influence that was Jewish and that he believed was dilatory to the music he cared about. Well, I don't know if this is helpful or not, but when Cecile and I moved to Paris for 7 years, we first felt very embraced by the French. And then after a little bit, you're in a big city and you realize, man, these folks are really rude. And your initial thought, or at least mine was, well, you know, maybe they don't like me because I'm American. And I'm pretty obviously, for several reasons, I don't look French, and I certainly didn't speak very good French. And so they knew immediately I was American. But then after some time living there, you realize, well, the fact is, actually, the French hate each other. So it's okay. They were rude to each other. I mean, and you know, big city, it's not any different than New York, of course, in that sense. I don't know what that's worth, but it did help us realize that there is not so much animus just directed at us because we were Americans. Well, this isn't a defense, but it does help to always remember that in this pre-Holocaust era, in this 19th century context, it was more politically okay to blame individual foibles upon one's ethnicity. And it was just a common thing. And however nasty Wagner was, everything we know about his priorities tell us that he would have never embraced violence, and certainly not the kind that we saw in the 20th century. Number two, and this is obviously related to this first point, ethnocentricity was in the 19th century water. And this is an era of extreme nationalism, as you know, of which anti-Semitism can be seen as a kind of subset. It was a particular vicious subset, but I think it's broadly right to remember how much various ethnicities actually hated each other and verbally did so, and in print, etc. Moreover, it is noted by some historians that Wagner also not only attacked Jews, but he also attacked Christians and the Christian tradition. He did not particularly like the sort of Platonic Augustinianism, the antibody, the distrust of emotions, the sort of downplay of passions that is often found in Protestantism, and for that matter, in Catholicism as well at times. And he was at times a very outspoken critic of his own Lutheran tradition. But of course, commentators are broadly in agreement that this criticism never reached that personal vitriol that his anti-Semitism did. Number three, Wagner hired many Jewish artists and had many, many Jewish friends. This is kind of related to the old saw, you know, I can't be racist, some of my best friends are black, or, you know, I don't know if I like gay people, but, you know, Steve is okay, or whatever. You know, it relates to this question. It's a very interesting question that I think all of us in various levels deal with in our own sense of prejudices. Throughout his life, Wagner had deep, deep Jewish friendships. In Paris, for example, there was a man named Samuel Lears, a Jewish scholar, about whom he writes in very, very intimate terms. His enthusiasm for their deep friendship is very evident in some of his letters. And that's early in his life. And then after that, there are friends like Carl Zotzig. Correct me if my pronunciation, if that's not right. He's a gifted student of Liszt who took over the administration of the Bayreuth patron's certificate for Wagner. And then, of course, these are my favorite two examples, and there are many of these examples. But these I find extraordinary. Angelo Neumann, who was the first to produce the ring, other than Wagner, and he did so with Wagner's permission. Jewish man. And this is even more astonishing to me, given his published views, that Hermann Levy, personally chosen by Wagner, to supervise the first performance of Wagner's last opera, Parsifal, and to do it at Bayreuth. And he became a fixture then at Bayreuth, and he would also not, it seems to me, not just incidentally, he would be a pallbearer at Wagner's funeral. So, can you be a racist and still have friends of another race? Well, of course. But historians are right to note that while Wagner was this anti-Semitite, he was at least at heart a hypocritical one. Which is a good thing, I guess. Number four, Wagner owed Jewish financiers a great deal of money. And oddly enough, they were always asked after him to pay it back. And so he hated that, and he hated them. Isn't it annoying that when you borrow money, people always want it back? I'm not here, I've decided not to go into a lot of detail, but suffice it to say that through a great deal of his life, Wagner was always running from his creditors. And until Ludwig II, King of Bavaria, fell in love with his music and then in love with Wagner and started funding his life, Wagner was in a financial mess, borrowing and borrowing and largely from Jewish financiers. There's in fact a funny story about when Ludwig decided to become a financier, wanted to search him out, some of his people were trying to find Wagner, and Wagner was running from anybody that looked like a collector, and so it took them a while to actually catch up with Wagner so they could give him money. It may or may not be a true story, but there are those like Brian McGee, who is a historian who's written a certain number of books on Wagner, who trace a good deal of at least the emotional ugliness in Wagner's language to both the Paris encounter and just to the fact that he was so angry about all this money that he owed, or a kind of debt guilt, if you will. And that unquestionably shapes a lot of his views. But of course, it doesn't exactly help our view of his character, does it? Number five, and lastly on this list, it might be worth noting, and maybe not, you could tell me later, that many very, very, very gifted Jewish musicians and Jewish intellectuals really loved Wagner. A slew of talented, exceptionally gifted musicians were in love with Wagner's music as anyone else, and they were, of course, very aware of his views. Two interesting examples, Mahler and Schoenberg, both of whom were lifelong victims of anti-Semitism, both idolized Wagner. The former, late in his life, wrote to his wife these words: "In music, there is only Beethoven and Wagner. After them, nobody." Maybe that's an exaggeration. Richard Strauss, of course, as probably most of you know, sometimes called Richard II after Wagner, is another example of somebody who, you could say, idolized and certainly followed musically Wagner. And of course, half of the great Wagnerian conductors in the 20th century, excepting Scott Schoonover, of course, were Jews. George Solti, James Levine, the list is kind of long. Now, this does nothing, in my view, to excuse or give any kind of cover, but it's information, and maybe in some cases speaks, of course, to the pre-Holocaust ease of just dismissing anti-Semitism as a way of saying that's just another form of nationalism, the way that maybe many of us in the room dismiss the racist jokes of our grandparents or something. But post Nazi Germany, it does become somewhat complicated. Well, I'm in these five things maybe underplaying some of the subtlety of all that's been reported by historians, But there's no doubt that all of these factors played a role and that do nuance, to some degree, our understanding of Wagner. Again, I have no interest in defending or explaining away his views. There is no excuse. But I do want to positively argue these two things quickly. Number one, as Oklahoma preachers were wont to say back when I was a kid, straight licks are hit by crooked sticks. That's a colloquial way of saying, you know, sometimes some very crooked people do something right. Number two, I think this is really interesting. The fact is, I think it can be argued the Nazis actually hated his music. Hitler loved his music, of course. He was a big fan, as you know, and most of his works, except Parsifal, he didn't really care for very much, and ultimately he was banned in Nazi Germany, the opera was. But it is kind of assumed because Hitler loved it and because some of Wagner's music is used in some of the filmography of Wagner, then it's assumed that the music just was loved by everyone who lived and worked, particularly those up the chain in the Nazi regime. But nothing is further from the truth. In fact, I mentioned this on the radio the other day, I find this fascinating. When Hitler came to power in 1932-33, there were 1,837 separate performances of Wagnerian operas. A few years later, 1939-1940, and still not in the height of the war years, of course, at least from the American perspective, it was less than two-thirds, 1,154. That's a big drop for a group of people that are supposedly in love with his music. There's also a very telling story from Nuremberg where during the early years, at a party rally, Hitler brought in the Berlin Orchestra to play Meistersinger. Great, great, great opera. Tickets were given to all party officials who, by and large, chose to spend the evening in beer halls and cafes. Hitler was infuriated, and he sent patrols to gather up the party functionaries. Well, the next year, he issued a command for attendance. So, of course, everybody showed up. But they yawned and snored their way through the opera, and so that even Hitler gave up on the idea, never again making the opera obligatory for the Nuremberg party meetings. Well, I agree wholeheartedly with the commentators and their legions who say something like this. The implications of the ring, and you'll see it when you come, because it will be evident even in what Wagner thought of as the prelude to his ring, Das Rheingold. The implications of the ring are the precise opposite of fascism. That the pursuit of power is incompatible with a life of true feeling. And therefore the attainment of it destroys the capacity for love. That's because power is inwardly destructive of the people who wield it. And it is, in the very deepest sense, anti-life. That necessary order should rest not on force, but on constant honoring of agreements. And force is the most disruptive of crimes. Part of what we just heard, I won't digress very much, but this argument that Wotan is having with his lovely wife is that, she's clearly not happy that her sister is going to be dragged off by the giants. But the issue is he's made an agreement, right? So there's this whole debate about whether he can break an agreement or not, or which is the value that trumps the other value, the keeping of the agreement or the value of Freya's life. And anyway, I could digress, but I shan't. But that whole story among multiple stories, of course, is all about this issue, fundamentally this issue of power and love and how does that get worked out with all the values we have in life. Okay. Well, that quote is from Brian McGee, and he provides a kind of a antidote that resonates with my experience and intuition. And so I just think it's simply a fact that fascism wouldn't sit comfortably with the themes that are in the ring. I want to move on to talk about then just briefly about Nietzsche. What do you know about Nietzsche? I doubt many of you have spent a lot of time recently reading a lot of Nietzsche, but you probably know enough about Nietzsche maybe to associate him with Nazi Germany. Brian McGree provides an anecdote that resonates when he talks about when he tells people I'm writing a book on Nietzsche and Wagner. They say, well, tell me a little bit about how much Nietzsche influenced Wagner. And it seems to me that so many of us go around thinking that that was the direction of the influence. And that, in fact, this all-moral philosopher who wrote about moving beyond morality and the will to power, that he influenced Wagner, who ended up writing music, kind of sing-song music for Hitler, which gave him a theme song for Nazism. But here are the facts. Nietzsche was 24. Wagner was 55 when they met. It was 1868. Wagner was born the same year as Nietzsche's father, and he was said to resemble him facially. When they met, Wagner was surfing the tidal wave of his international fame. Meistersingers was a world premiere, had happened earlier to get great acclaim. Tristan, 3 years earlier. And there's only one work that he hadn't yet begun when he met Nietzsche, and that was Parsifal. So there's no real question about this 24-year-old having undue influence on Wagner, of course, who is famously domineering. And Nietzsche, while exceptionally gifted and intelligent classics poet in Basel at the age of 24, but he was retiring, somewhat shy. And his very first book is quite clearly evident that he was under Wagner's sway. It's a book filled with really Wagner's ideas, and some, I think, argue correctly, modeled even on Wagner's prose, which was laborious and very Germanic in the Hegelian sense. If any of you read the old German philosophy and know how well less and succinct they were in their writing, Wagner wrote in that kind of style. And Nietzsche showed none of what he would later demonstrate in his extraordinary style and wit. They were, however, very close, and some say that Nietzsche was in love with Wagner, maybe, and some say that he was in love with Wagner's wife, very possibly. Regardless, what happened years later, when Nietzsche saw Wagner's embrace of aristocracy and some of the moneyed powers as he was building Bayreuth, he didn't like it. And partly for that reason, probably for other interpersonal reasons, he ended up breaking with Wagner and wrote some critical work of him, in fact. He particularly didn't like Wagner's embrace of love, though. And in fact, he called Parsifal, again, Wagner's last opera, cleaned up Christianity for female Wagnerians. In case there's any question, that's not a compliment. So, what was Wagner, who seemed to hate a race of people, but who loved many individual examples of it, what was he trying to say in his operas? That's what I want to talk a little bit about next week, going into, I hope, some interesting detail about two philosophers, Feuerbach and someone who really, really influenced Wagner very philosophically and influenced him a great deal, Schopenhauer. And I'll talk about those a little bit and what some of the themes that then he musically as well as mythically attempted to deal with in his operas. I think we all know, if we just survey his life, that we need to be somewhat leery of learning anything from him, but at the same time, at least many of us, as I've been saying, can't help ourselves trying to understand thematically why we find these stories so compelling and why musically we feel as if we enter a different time zone when Wagner is playing. Possibly. Tell me if you agree later. Possibly because of some internal inexplicable hatred, Wagner knew the importance of love. Maybe because of his issues of dominance that he had towards everybody, he grappled, maybe more than some, with the corruption of power. Possibly because of his unfaithfulness, he understood passion and its limits better than many. I will close with Owen Lee, who quotes Edmund Wilson very appropriately in this context. The victim of a malarious disease which renders that victim abhorrent to society and periodically degrades him and makes him helpless is also the master of a superhuman art which everyone has to respect and which the normal man finds he needs. It is the nature of our human divine world. One cannot have the irresistible weapon without its loathsome owner. Thank you very much.